Certainly happy to come before you this evening in a good situation. About a week ago, you might not have come back to a building here. You might not have been able to assemble together and know that everyone is okay. Typically, there are four questions that people ask when tragedy strikes. The first might be, what happened? It was a car accident, or you hear something over the phone, but in this case, we know what happened. A storm came. So the second question someone might ask, was everybody okay? Was there anybody hurt? Then that may be followed up with, well, what happened? Did y'all lose anything? What happened to your property? And then the question that may follow that later is, how are you dealing with it? How are you feeling about it? For Christians, many times that answer is very simple. We're going to be okay. We're going to be okay. And many of you probably said that over and over again, being asked, we're going to be okay. We have insurance. Or if you don't have insurance, you say, we're still going to be okay. But sometimes people say, I just don't know what's going to happen. And that's certainly okay. It's okay to say sometimes, I just don't know what's going to happen. I don't know where we go from here. Especially someone who may have lost everything. This lesson I worked on way before the hurricane was ever in the Gulf. But you know how the scriptures work and how God's word works together. This morning, HD spoke up, stood up here and spoke about trusting in God. And that's what we're going to talk about this evening. We're going to look at Abraham from Genesis. And we're going to make three points looking at Abraham and trust. And understand that we need to trust in God. And sometimes it's okay not to know. But we still put our trust in God. And ultimately, we want to trust God and obey. In Genesis chapter 12 and verse 1, the Bible says, Now the Lord had said to Abram, Get out of your country, from your family, and from your father's house to a land that I will show you. Why did I have chapter 11, verse 31 read as a scripture reading? Because I don't know if you knew, and I really had forgotten, the journey really wasn't started because Abram wanted to go, or that God had initially asked him. He really set out on the journey because his father had says, come on, we're going to go. And his father didn't make the whole journey. He passed away. That's chapter 11, verse 31. He died, so they stopped. They came to Haran, and they dwelt there. In verse 32, so the days of Terah was 205 years, and Terah died in Haran. And so they stayed there. But then God says to Abram, get you out of your land, leave and go to a place that I will show you. Chapter 12, God calls Abram to move to a land he would show him, and Lot comes along with him. So the lesson we might be able to get out of this, and we'll continue to look at this, is trust God when he asks you to do something you might feel uncomfortable with. Imagine what it was like when Abram was asked, and we don't know for sure how Abram felt, but what if we're in a situation where we look into God's word, and God's word says, go. Or God's word says, make disciples. Or God's word says, know my will, seek my paths, live your life according to my will. For some people, that's hard to do. That's very difficult to do, because you're completely giving up your own thought process, your own will and desire to turn to God. And many times it's hard to convert people because you're asking them to leave behind everything they've ever known, everything they've ever been taught or believed in, and follow God's way. And it's hard. In this case, imagine how Abram might have felt. God says, leave and go to a place I'm going to show you. There was no map. There was no GPS or some image. And God said, look, here's where you're going to go, and this is the route you're going to go, and there you go. You've got plenty of supplies. It's going to be okay. It's not just Abram and his wife getting up and leaving. It's Abram and his wife, Sarah, however you want to say it, Sarah. Her name changes to Sarah. And then Lot's going to go also. And it's not just Lot, but it's all their family and other members of the family, and they're going to go, and they're going to travel, and they're going to leave because God says, get up and go. Trust in God no matter what he asks of you. He is asking you to move, in a sense, be ready to move. Hebrews chapter 11, verses 8 through 10. The Hebrew writer records some facts and some truths about Abraham. And he says in verse 8 of Hebrews chapter 11, By faith Abraham obeyed when he was called to go out of the place which he would receive as an inheritance. And he went out not knowing where he was going. He didn't even know. God says, get up and go to a place. I'm going to show you. The Bible tells us he didn't even know. He didn't even know where he was going. Talk about trust. Talk about believing. Talk about having faith in God. God doesn't set before us a path today as he does, or as he did Abraham, and says, look, just go to this place. I'm going to show you where to go. And we just go. And maybe day by day we're waiting for more instructions. We don't know how it worked for Abraham. God has set us on a path through his word and obedience and told us exactly what we must do to get to the end destination. It's even more clear for us now because God says, here's what I want from you. Here's what you have to do to be my child. Here's what you have to do to worship me. Here's what you have to do to be faithful to me and make me happy. And it's not about merit. It's not about, look, God, I did all these things for you. Now I deserve heaven. That's not it at all. By his grace, he said, here's the path. Here's the way I want you to live, and I will give you eternal life. So Abraham was asked to go to a place he didn't even know. Verse 9 of Hebrews chapter 11. By faith he dwelt in the land of promise as in a foreign country, dwelling in tents, and Isaac and Jacob and the heirs with him of the same promise. In verse 10, for he waited for the city which has foundations, whose builder and maker is God. See, his ultimate goal was the same as our ultimate goal, was that God's promised me something. And no matter if I know the path, no matter if I know how I'm going to get there or not, I'm still going to trust God. You may be in a situation now where something bad happened to your house, to your property, and you may say, I just don't know what we're going to do. And that's okay. It's okay because you can turn to your left, you can turn to your right. You probably already had people coming and helping you and offering assistance. And you, many of you have already gone and offered assistance to people who may have lost everything. We have each other. In God's wisdom, we can see that. We can see the benefits of coming together and worshiping. Because yes, we are praising and worshiping God, but you ever even realize just how wise God is in knowing what you and I need from each other? One of those things is support in time of need. We're not supposed to go through life all on our own with no assistance. We have each other, and you're to be greatly commended for that. For giving of your time and of your money. And you know, they keep talking about Texas. I wasn't born in Texas, but I think I've been here long enough to be proud to be a Texan. And they keep saying over and over again, the liberal media hates it. Because people are coming together and they're not getting anything out of it but just to help other people. And that's the way we ought to be with each other. You're my brother or sister in Christ. I'll do whatever it takes to help you. We have a God. We have each other. We know where we're going. We know how we can get there. Trust in God and bring others along with you. Because that's what Abram did. He brought Lot along with him. We know eventually what happens down the road. We won't have that point in our lesson, but it gets to the point where Abram is pleading with God, please, don't destroy Sodom and Gomorrah. And he goes, and those numbers dwindle down, and he gets down to that final number, and there's not enough faithful people, and so God's going to destroy it. And then, of course, Lot has to leave with his two daughters, and you know how that turned out. Your influence, your example, and your influence might help someone else along the way. They may not understand where you're going. They may not understand how to get there, but because your example, you might be able to bring others along. Point number two, in Genesis chapter 12 and verse 3, the Bible says, God speaks to Abram, says, I will bless those who bless you. I will curse who curses you. And in you all the families of the earth shall be blessed. This continues on. It spread out over time in Genesis chapter 13, verses 14 through 16. Again, God makes a promise and he says, lift your eyes now and look at the place where you are, northward, southward, eastward, and westward. For all the land which you see, I give you and your descendants forever. And I will make your descendants as the dust of the earth, so that if a man could number the dust of the earth, then your descendants also could be numbered. And it even continues on. In Genesis chapter 15 and verse 5. Then he brought him the outside and he says, look now towards heaven and count the stars if you're able to number them. And he said to him, so shall your descendants be. The dust, the sand, all the little grains. You go, some of you probably have it in your house, you don't even want it there. live close to the beach, and you just pick up a handful and try to count them out. It's near impossible. It's not worth your time to try to count them out. But God says to Abram, that's what your descendants are going to be. And then he says, look at the stars. If you can try to even begin to count them, even with our modern technology, we'll never be able to count all the stars. Doesn't that show you the wonderful power and might of God? That the stars are out there, and he created them in one day. And they're out there for us to look and to see just how wonderful he is. But also to look and to say, those are all the descendants. They count the number of the stars. And then in Genesis chapter 17, verses 1 and 2, when Abram was 99 years old, the Lord appeared to Abram and said to him, I am Almighty God, walk before me and be blameless. And I will make my covenant between you, between me and you, and you will multiply and will multiply you exceedingly. And Abram fell on his face, and God talked to him, saying, as for me, behold, my covenant is with you, and you shall be a father of many nations. This promise was over time, and he keeps telling him, you're going to be blessed, you're going to be blessed, your descendants are going to be blessed, and all nations will be blessed by you. What lesson do we get from this? Trust God when he promises you something, or he says that he is going to do something for you. That's what he promised to Abram. He promised Abram, by your seed, all nations will be blessed. They'll be numbered to the point you can't even begin to imagine how many. You know what? Abraham saw the land. He saw the land. It was given to him. He was promised that his descendants would be numbered as the stars in the sand and they would possess the land. Never lived to see it. He was promised that all nations would be blessed through him. Never lived to see it. Of those three promises, only one of those did he ever really see. But he still trusted in God. He still believed in God. We know how the story ends. Jesus came many, many, many years later, and through him, through the seed of Abraham, were all nations blessed by Jesus and his sacrifice. In Hebrews chapter 11, verses 12 through 16, therefore from one man, and him as good as dead, were born as many as the stars of the sky, and the multitude innumerable as the sand which is by the seashore. The Hebrew writer talks about there is the promise revealed. It came through Christ, and Abraham never saw it. What about for you and I? Has God made promises to us? Has he promised us anything? Things that we would be able to see and know because of God's promises that we can trust in him? Certainly so. In Matthew chapter 6, verses 25 through 33, you know what verse 33 says. Seek ye first the kingdom of God and his righteousness, and all these things shall be added unto you. What's God going to do? He's promised that he's going to take care of your physical needs. That doesn't mean we're going to have so much money, we're just going to be overflowing, and we never go without all the specific things that we need. You may have tried to go to HEB or Walmart, and you really wanted that certain brand of coffee, and they just didn't have it. You know what? It's okay. Because you had food on the table. You had something to eat. We've never gone in a situation where our country has suffered, that we have suffered to the point where we just didn't know from day to day what we were going to eat. And there are some people in the world that are like that. God's promised he'll take care of our physical needs, but he never promised that he'll give you more than you can even imagine. He will take care of us, and we trust that that's true. He's also promised that he'll forgive us of our sins. In Hebrews chapter 8 and verse 12, the Bible says, their sins and their lawless deeds I will remember no more. He'll forgive you of your sins if you're willing to be obedient to him, to give your life to him, and trust his promises. He'll take those sins away. In 1 John 1, 7 and 9, he says, walk in the light as he is in the light, Christ is, and fellowship one with another, and the blood of Jesus continually washes away our sins. And then in verse 9, if we confess our sins, he's faithful and just to forgive us of all unrighteousness. God's promised that he'll do it. Even to the point where we feel like there's no way God could forgive me. There's no way he would be willing to forget my sins. God's promises are true. You can trust in God that you can have your sins forgiven. God's also promised that he'll be on our side even in tough times. In Psalm 118 and verse 6, the psalmist says, the Lord is on my side, I will not fear. What can man do to me? If I truly trust in God, I'm not worried about what happens in the storm. I'm not worried about what someone's going to say or do to me if I try to live a Christian life. Because God is on my side. That's all that really matters. That's all that really matters is God's on my side. And as we mentioned earlier, you have brothers and sisters. We have brothers and sisters that love us and will be there for us. But if there was no one else around us, we have God and He'll never fail us. In Hebrews 13 and verse 5, the Hebrew writer says, He Himself has said, I will never leave you nor forsake you. In Isaiah chapter 59, Isaiah makes it clear why God had dismissed the people, why God would not look upon the people anymore, because He says, your sins, your iniquities, God's ear is not so heavy that He cannot hear, and His hand is not short that He cannot save, but their sins had turned them away from God. God's always going to be there. He's always going to support you, but only if you will remain in the right relationship with Him. God's trust is never going to dwindle away. It's never going to be taken away as long as we live faithfully to Him. And then the last promise we can understand and know God's going to give us as a reward in heaven. In Revelation chapter 2 and verse 10, of course, speaking to one of the seven churches there, and a verse we know and quote so many times, be thou faithful unto death and I'll give thee a crown of life. God's promised us eternal life. We know that promise is true. We know it. Point number three, the last example from Abraham about trust is from Genesis chapter 22. Genesis chapter 22, verses 1 and 2, and then verses 8 and 10. What's happened is that time has passed. Isaac has been born. He has grown up, and God says to Abraham, I want you to take Isaac, and I want you to go up on the mount and offer a sacrifice. What was peculiar about this is God says, I want you to take your son and offer him as a sacrifice. In verse 2, he says, then he said, take now your son, your only son Isaac, whom you love, and go to the land of Moriah and offer him there as a burnt offering on one of the mountains of which I should tell you. And then in verse 8, and Abram said, my son, God will provide for himself the land for a lamb for a burnt offering. So the two of them went together. Then they came to the place which God had told him, and Abraham built an altar there and placed the wood in the order. And he bound Isaac his son and laid him on the altar upon the wood. In verse 10, and Abram stretched out his hand and took the knife to slay his son. Trust God if He asks you to sacrifice something. I'm so thankful and God doesn't ask us to sacrifice our own children, because there's no way that I would be able to take any of my sons up on a mountain and offer them as a sacrifice. So you feel the same way about your children. I'm thankful that God does not ask us to do that. But He asked Abraham to do that. He asked Abraham to sacrifice something, and it wasn't his time, it wasn't his money or his good deeds or offering a Bible lesson to someone, knocking on someone's door. It was offering up his son. You know there's Old Testament principles that carry over to the New Testament. We very clearly see here the idea of offering a son as a sacrifice, giving up a son, and we can see the foreshadowing of this and know that God was going to give His only begotten son. Facts with this. When you consider what's going on here, not one time do we have any record that Abraham questions God. What, God, why are you asking me to do this? Are you kidding me? You're asking me to give up my son? It's not recorded in the Bible. Another fact, something that we don't read, is that he did not argue with God. He didn't blame God. He didn't get angry. He simply just trusted and he obeyed. And then, another fact, he didn't lose his faith in God. He didn't quit. He didn't give up on God and say, you know what, this is not worth it. If that's what you're going to ask me to do, I'm done. I'm finished. That wasn't it. We don't see that at all. Some people might say, well, there was blind faith. He was going to do it. He didn't know what the outcome was, but we don't believe in blind faith. Never do we have blind faith to the point where we just say, well, I'm just going to believe it because he says to do it, and I don't really know why, but I'm just going to do it. If that's the way we approach serving God, and trusting in God, and then we might want to reconsider our trust. Don't obey just because your family has obeyed. Don't obey just because you're afraid someone might call you or knock on your door and ask why you weren't at worship service. Don't obey just because you're afraid the elders might come and visit with you and talk about withdrawing fellowship if you don't come back and restore your service to God. Don't do it just because you're afraid someone might say something or something might, you know, might be uncomfortable for you. Obey because you love God. That's what Abraham did. He loved God. He loved God to the point that whatever God was going to ask him to do, he was going to do it. He was going to sacrifice his son. The Hebrew writer tells us in Hebrews chapter 11, verses 17 through 19, and I love this because you don't read this in Genesis, but it's true, and the Holy Spirit inspired the Hebrew writer to say, you know what? Abraham knew, even if he had gone up there and actually sacrificed his son, that God could have brought him back from the dead. That's the kind of faith and trust that Abraham had. That even if he did go through with it and did have to offer Isaac as a sacrifice, Hebrews 11, verse 19, concluding that God was able to raise him up even from the dead. You ever think about Isaac? You think about Isaac? The Bible does not give us an example of Isaac arguing with his father or saying, what are you doing, Dad? No, don't do this. No, there's no... You don't see that. You don't read it. That doesn't mean it didn't happen, but it's just not recorded. We don't have that instance. What could that tell us? That could tell us as parents, as examples to others, that when they see our faith and our trust in God and our obedience to God, that they also will be brought up understanding and knowing that same thing. Jesus says in John 14 and verse 15, if you love me, keep my commandments. When others around us see our love for God, that we're willing to keep his commandments and there's no compromise, our own children see that, then they learn to love and trust and obey God. You better believe it. I said it to Joseph many times. If you love God, you'll love me. Hebrews chapter 6 and verse 1, children, obey your parents in the Lord, for this is right. Children, obey and trust your parents. Their intentions are to help you get to heaven. Obey and trust them. Love them and know that they may tell you no sometimes, but it's because they love you. And parents, sometimes we have to say no because we love and because we trust and we want to do what God has to say. What lesson do we get from this sacrifice? Trust in God, or from this example of Abraham, trust in God when he asks you to sacrifice something. You know what Jesus said? In Matthew chapter 16, if he says, if any man will come after me, let him deny himself, take up his cross, and follow me. Jesus is asking you, through his word this evening, to give up yourself. Deny yourself. Be willing to put that aside, to forget your own feelings, your desires, your wants, whatever it is you think you need in life. Trusting in things that are not worth trusting in. And he wants you to deny yourself and to give up that hope, that thought, that idea, to trust in him. And then as Paul would write in Philippians 3, verses 7 and 8, he says, but those things that were gained to me, those I counted lost for Christ. There may be situations and times where you could benefit here on earth, that you could gain, that you could really be prosperous. But because you love God, you're willing to sacrifice, you're willing to give up those opportunities. I'll use this one example and then we'll close the lesson. There was a man many years ago when I was a teenager, when I was still at home, that he had a very good job driving a truck. And he was driving from North Alabama to Memphis. It was a very easy trip. And then they came to him and said, look, we really want you to drive. We want to make you a longer trip. And I don't remember what the route was. And he was going to make a lot of money doing it. And it's always stuck in my mind as a teenager because it was money. And as a teenager, you think, I want to make money. I want to go to school and I want to make money. He gave up a lot of money and said, I'll just quit truck driving because what it's going to do is it's going to take away my opportunities to teach my children and to worship and serve God. Could he have made some worship services? Yes, but he wasn't going to sacrifice that to make a lot of money. And that always stuck with me, and I share that with you this evening. Sometimes those are the types of sacrifices we have to make. Sacrificing the time we want to spend doing something, the money that we want to make because we love God so much that we're willing to sacrifice, as Abraham was willing to sacrifice. This evening, maybe there's something that you need. You need prayers. You need help in some way spiritually. We'll be willing to pray with you and pray for you. The effectual, fervent prayer of a righteous man availeth much. Maybe your trust has failed you. Maybe because of things that happened in the past few weeks have caused you to doubt a little bit. We'll be willing to help you in any way. Maybe you're not trusting in God because you're not a Christian. You haven't put on Christ in baptism to be a child of God. And you're not fully trusting in Him as you could. This evening, if you want to become a Christian, we ask that you please come. Don't hesitate. Put on Christ. Trust God and serve Him while we stand and sing.